My mistake. He's not. Yeah.
I'd like to call the Mentor City Council regular meeting of Tuesday, January 17th, 2017 to order. The invocation will be given this evening by Councilman Marne.
Heavenly Father, we thank thee for this day. Help us to use good judgment for the business at hand and guide us in wisdom with a continued sense of truth and fairness for the community we represent.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Julie, please call the roll.
Mr. Marne?
Here.
Mr. Blake?
Here.
Mr. Donovan?
Here.
Mrs. Dowling?
Here.
Mr. Kirchner?
Here.
Mr. Krieger?
Here.
Mr. Landig?
Here.
Council's in receipt of the minutes of the work session of January 3rd, 2017.
Move to approve.
Second.
Please call the roll.
Mr. Marne?
Yes.
Mr. Blake?
Yes.
Mr. Donovan?
Yes.
Mrs. Dowling?
Yes.
Mr. Kirchner?
Yes.
Mr. Krieger?
Yes.
Mr. Landig?
Yes.
And the regular meeting of January 3rd, 2017.
Move to approve.
Second.
Please call the roll.
Mr. Marne?
Yes.
Mr. Blake?
Yes.
Mr. Donovan?
Yes.
Mrs. Dowling?
Yes.
Mr. Kirchner?
Yes.
Mr. Krieger?
Yes.
Mr. Landig?
Yes.
Public hearings, we have none. New legislation. Ordinance number 17-0-08.
An ordinance amending Part 5, Chapter 505 of the Codified Ordinances of the City of Mentor 2006 as amended, the same relating to general offenses, animals and fowl, definitions, and feeding or harbor of nuisance health risk animals.
I'll defer to the law director for some brief discussion.
Okay. This legislation works in companion with the existing Section 505.21 of the Mentor Code of Ordinances under the general offenses, and that specific ordinance prohibits the feeding of nuisance health risk animals. This ordinance enlarges the specific definition of what that of what a nuisance health risk animal would be to add feral cats, and there's a definition of feral cats, and by adopting this legislation, you would thereby prohibit the feeding of feral cats. And if there are any additional questions, I can try to answer them, but that's about it.
Mr. Filipiak?
Thank you, Madam President. I don't have a lot to add. I think it's worth pointing out that the reason that this came before Council's review is really in response to our attempts at trying to meet community needs and problems that has developed in the community over the years from colonies of feral cats that are causing problems within particular neighborhoods. Our city, much like most communities, struggle with how to best deal with these scenarios where large populations of feral cats adopt a neighborhood and create the type of nuisance and health-related risks that accompany them. So I think we're all happy to get that conversation started a couple weeks ago at Council's work session. I know that much like so many of the topics that we discuss, this provides a starting point for a good community discussion on the matter. And I think it's probably worth pointing out to the public who's here, which I think we're all glad to see so many people weighing in on the issue, is that there are a number of other topics that were included within the scope of this discussion that included everything from a trap, neuter, and release program to working with agencies like the Humane Society and the Health District, as well as working with other communities who we have tried to take examples from who may have conducted or started down the path of trying to address these type of issues in their cities. That's really where we are. This is a starting point, and I think it was one of the few items that came out of two weeks ago, our work session, that became very clear that I think what everyone recognizes is that providing sources of food for feral cat populations without any additional action tends to lead to an increase in the number of cats. And so, as I said, this is a starting point. that may or may not result in legislation or additional action, but it's where we begin.
Thank you. We have several people.
Question. I know we've talked about this, Tony and Ken. When you say starting point, do we feel that this has to be the absolute point A if we're going to try to do something with the situation? I know we're open to other options and we're looking into other options, but explain starting point and why this would have to be a starting point.
Well, it's a piece of legislation, much like other pieces before council, that ultimately starts off as something and either is rejected in its entirety, is changed and altered in a manner that improves upon it, and ultimately ends up in a final form that I think tries to satisfy as many interested parties or stakeholders that legislation deals directly with. In this case, it's really just an attempt to start the conversation.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
Any other comments before we? Okay. All of us have appreciated, we've received a lot of emails and phone calls over this past week, and a lot of good information, had some good discussions with people. And I think that everybody is looking towards coming to some kind of resolution. So we have quite a few people that want to speak tonight. We want to gather the information, and each of you may have a different viewpoint. We would ask that I noticed there are several people that are from similar groups, so it would be helpful if the comments not be redundant, if someone from your group has stated that point, that you provide, you know, your set of facts and your information and your experience with doing it, and it will help it to move along. We do have a 4-minute limit, and we're not going to take people in any particular order, so I'm just going to start out with the first person. I'm going to ask Cindy Valerio to come to the podium. And please identify yourself.
Hi, can you hear me okay?
No?
Yell? Okay, my name is Cindy Valerio. I'm with Community Cat Companions, Inc. I am a 501c3 located in Cuyahoga County. However, I sponsor three groups which are in Lake County. One of those is in Willowick. We have a group in Eastlake as well as in Mentor. Our Willowick group does have an ordinance that is actually tied to TNR. We have a TNR ordinance there. We don't in Eastlake, but we would certainly like to do something like that in Mentor. Something else that we also sponsor is a pet food pantry, which is located in Willowick, and we have a voucher program that we started last year to help colony caregivers cover the cost of TNRing their cats. I'm not going to go into a long detailed thing about TNR. I know that there are other people here that want to talk about TNR, the benefits, why it works, why feeding bans don't work, et cetera. What I really want to talk about is kind of what we do. Our groups are all dedicated to improving the lives of feral cats. But we also, our goal is to limit their numbers. TNR, you will hear, is the most effective and humane method of managing feral colonies. We don't do this by ourselves. We have very many partners. We partner with area clinics that actually do the surgeries. They do the spaying, neutering. They do all the vaccinating and ear tipping of the cats. We partner with shelters that place the cats. We deal with municipalities. We also deal with community outreach organizations and our own pet food pantry to keep cats in their homes by providing things like low-cost spay and neuter to owned pets, you know, pet food assistance, et cetera. Dogs are surrendered to shelters. Cats often are just abandoned and thrown out on the street. So that's where we are with cats. We also partner with the pet supply stores. We get food donations. We hold events. They offer low-cost veterinary services. We deal with a lot of people. Homelessness is not an issue of just TNR. TNR is one component. It's an important component. But all of these organizations and everybody work together to reduce the numbers of homeless cats in our area. Nationally, the trend is trending down. There are fewer cats going into shelters than there have been in the past. Our region is following that trend as well. In fact, in your package, you'll have intake numbers from area shelters and what it is. We are especially seeing a drop in kittens, which eventually will translate into adult cats as well. You will hear a lot of reasons why feeding bans don't work. They don't work. They're not enforceable, and they make life miserable for us. When we are going out there and trying to trap and neuter, having municipalities or whatever tell people that they can't feed, really, it just prevents them from stepping forward and letting us do what we do. Our groups in 2016 trapped 900 cats total. 525 of those cats were returned to managed colonies. That means a colony where there is a dedicated caregiver that feeds the cats. The cats are spayed and neutered. They are doing it in a responsible manner. 375 of those cats were adopted. There are many stray cats in feral colonies, cats that are friendly, cats that don't belong outside, have been in a home. We take them off the streets along with the kittens that are adoptable. That's about 40% of them are not returned. And of course, in those figures are tons of pregnant cats. So I'm going to pass it on to somebody else, and they're going to tell you a lot more, I'm sure, but I hope that you keep this in mind. We don't do this alone, and we certainly can't do it with all the caregivers out there. Thank you.
Thank you. The next speaker is Dan Lark.
Good evening. My name is Dan Lark. I'm with the Lake County General Health District. And came to talk a little bit about it, but in general, we recommend that people do not feed, give shelter to, or interact with wild animals. If a person is bit or scratched by one of these animals, it can lead to serious disease. And at that point, you don't have any injury, could be hard to locate the animal. They can carry parasites, bacterial and virus infections that are transmittable to humans, and carry campylobacter, hookworm, ringworm, and a couple of rare ones, plague, Q fever, rabies, salmonella, toxoplasmosis, and some larval diseases. The feral cats can also pass diseases on to your household animals. And I talked to the state zoonotic disease agency today, and they said that these cats don't have the proper vaccinations and stuff, and it's preventing is a lot cheaper than starting post-exposure prophylaxis if you do get exposed to these cats rather than starting shots up. So that's all. Thank you.
Thank you. Madam President? Dan, one question.
Yeah.
How many complaints or cases has the Lake Health Organization
had? We get them on a steady basis. We haven't kept them number-wise on feral cats, but we get them on a routine basis, people feeding cats. And so our standard thing is...
I mean about the scratches and all this stuff where they've been bitten or scratched by an animal.
We get hundreds a year of scratches and bites. I could get you the council a number tomorrow, actually, an actual number of scratches and bites, if they'd like.
Thank you. Okay. The next speaker is Shane Guy.
Council, folks, hello. I'm Shane Guy. I live in Painesville. I work in Mentor. I do work with Mentor Community Cats as well. I'd like to contradict some of the things that the gentleman just said. I'd also like to wonder how many of those scratches and bites are from companion animals inside a house and how many are documented from ferals. The logic of feeding bans seems to be that a feeding ban would starve off the cats or possibly make them too sickly to reproduce. This is a cruel logic and also flawed. It simply does not work. The feline species in general have survived for millions of years. They have survived ice ages. You cannot kill off these skilled hunters by simply removing their kibble and their fancy feast canned food. If you take away a convenient food source, you also force them to hunt, potentially offending the bird and chipmunk lovers in the community. The only effective way to reduce the cat population is TNR. Groups like Mentor Community Cats humanely trap, spay and neuter, and vaccinate cats before returning them to the community. They also find homes for dumped house cats and kittens in the process, lowering the number of cats in the community. They euthanize suffering cats when necessary, population is controlled effectively, and numbers decline naturally with time. As far as the idea that cats are a public health risk, according to research, a mountain of the best quality research from the CDC and Cornell University and a host of other science-based sources points out that outdoor cats pose no health risk to human beings. Simply stating that a cat may carry diseases does not mean that they are even capable of transmitting them to humans. The majority of common cat diseases are not zoonotic. That is to say that they cannot be passed from one species to another. Since these diseases prey on the different immune systems of different species, for example, you cannot catch bronchitis from your cat. And likewise, if your house cat snuggles up to you to comfort you when you're sick, that cat cannot catch your pneumonia or flu or bronchitis. Even conjunctivitis, which is commonly called pink eye, is one of the most communicable diseases between humans and humans, or between cats and cats, cannot pass from cats to human beings. This leaves several diseases that can transfer but are less of a threat to anyone than being hit by lightning or winning the lottery. Rabies in cats is incredibly rare, and if you can get close enough to a skittish feral cat to be bitten, you possess some kind of magic that the best of us that care for cats do not possess. Scratches can become infected, but again, ferals do not like to be touched, and they run as soon as approached. Ringworm fungus, likewise, depends upon direct contact with the cat. And cats who are TNR'd, again, are vaccinated against rabies and other diseases and are treated for active illnesses. This is your best defense against disease from cats in the community, is to allow TNR and allow us to step in and help these cats. Toxoplasmosis from cats is only a danger to a tiny percentage of pregnant or immunocompromised people. Even when people or cats contract toxoplasmosis, there are generally no adverse symptoms. And the risk of toxoplasmosis is highly increased in cats who eat raw meat regularly, meaning that if you're feeding cats kibble, they're much less likely to go out, hunt, and get toxoplasmosis. Again, everything points back to TNR as being the best solution for what some people, you know, perceive to be a problem. If toxoplasmosis were a problem, it would affect literally billions of people who scoop the litter of their domestic cats every day. And this would end cats as pets altogether. And we know that's just not happening. Since feral cats bury their waste, no one is likely to come in direct contact with their feces outdoors. The billions of domestic cats in the world raises another issue. There's a saying on the internet that the internet is composed of cats. What this refers to is that millions of pictures of cute and funny cats and kittens circulate the web every day via social media. Cats are beloved of people, most people. On the way here tonight, I passed a license plate that said C-A-T space L-V-E-R, and presumably that's cat lover and not cat liver. Enacting a feeding ban will anger a majority of constituents, all because a small minority of how many? Two, three, a half a dozen people have complained and are irrationally afraid of cats. Where is the democracy in a ban? Constituents who complain of cats defecating in their mulch, for example, should take personal responsibility and buy inexpensive, effective, non-toxic cat repellents that are readily available and do not require often reapplication. Feeding bans divide a community against itself.
Your time's a little bit up if you would wind down.
Oh, yes. Okay.
Thank you.
TNR depends upon community cat givers who know the schedule and the whereabouts of these cats so that we can effectively trap them. On one street in Mentor on the Lake last year, the street was not a quarter mile long. We TNR'd dozens of cats and pulled out 50 kittens that we rehomed into homes. Now, those 50 kittens, if allowed to stay there, this coming spring, they would have had, on the average, two litters of at least three kittens apiece. That means not only 50 kittens did we take out, that's 150 additional cats we prevented, not to mention the cats that would have been born of the adult cats that we TNR. In short, it's my sincere and respectful hope that council, as has been done in Willowick, will choose the only effective and humane means of dealing with feral cats, that of entering into an agreement with TNR organizations. For the sake of both community and cats, this is the only real solution.
Thank you.
What is this?
I would like to request that any comments be addressed to council, not to other speakers, not to get into discussion. If you would direct your comments to us, that would be appreciated. Thank you. Next, we have Sharon Moten, M-O-T-E-N. Okay. You disappeared.
I know that most of you associate me with dogs.
Yes.
But I am here for the cats tonight. So when I heard that there was a problem with feral cats, I knew I had to come speak, because to me the problem with feral cats is a secondary problem. The real problem are the people that dump them. I'm a dog lover. I've always had all dogs. I have four cats, thanks to the heartless people in my neighborhood that threw them out on the street. One was 2 weeks old and had to be bottle fed. I knew nothing about cats. I had to learn trial by fire. The next cats that showed up at my house, I wished to my neighbor who now owns them. But these are the people that really need to be addressed. That's where some focus. I don't think we have laws about it. And I know it's hard to track, but a lot of apartments in Menor particularly, people get evicted or move out, and there seems to be a huge problem. These people are not getting their cats spayed or neutered, and they throw them outside, or some even left them locked in their apartment, and they weren't discovered for 3 weeks. So I would love to see some laws, and I think these people in apartments, they know who they are, to track these people, and there should be some sort of fine for these people for not taking care of it. The other thing I would like to say is, suggesting that the kind-hearted people that care enough to try to assume the problem someone else left behind, these are not the people to punish. And these aren't just individuals. I think you'd be surprised how many businesses in Menor also create shelters and feed these cats, but they know to contact people to get them spayed and neutered. So that's a big thing, is getting the information out there to people so that they know to contact all these wonderful people who work so hard in the community. And I'm not sure the city of Menor knows how much work has been going on and how much time and money these individuals have given to try and solve this problem. There are low-cost spay-neuter programs out there. These people will help any individual out there with it. It'd be great if people were more aware of these programs and how inexpensive it would be to get their cat spayed and neutered. Now, I don't know a whole lot about the law. I would love to see it a law that your cats have to be spayed and neutered, because unlike my dogs, which are leashed or in a fenced yard, these cats can roam the neighborhood. And if somebody lets their cats in and out and they're not spayed or neutered, you're creating another problem right there. So I'm going to wind this up by saying that cruelty to animals is illegal, and thanks to the wonderful Dick Goddard, those laws were increased. My personal opinion is to suggest that these kind people not feed cats. Starving an animal is cruelty, and I don't want to live in a city who thinks that that is the right way to deal with a problem. And I know most of you, and I know that you're really great people, so I want to be in the city with heart that's going to work with the trap, neuter, release people and see the wonderful work that they've been doing and create a program with them to hopefully get these cats taken care of and get this number reduced and make it not be a problem anymore for City of Menor. Thank you.
Thank you.
May I make one comment?
Yes, ma'am.
Just for everyone's benefit. It's a first-degree misdemeanor in the city of Menor to abandon a dog or a cat. So we do have an ordinance, in the very chapter that this ordinance that we're talking about today applies to. So that, just want you to know that we do have that. We do have that.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you, Richard. Next, we have Christina Manley.
Hello. I'm sorry, I'm very nervous.
My name is Christina Manley. I reside in the city of Mentor. My attendance here tonight is to oppose the council's proposed ban of feeding feral cats. I grew up in Mentor. I graduated from Mentor High and Lakeland. In 2013, my husband and I purchased a house on the same street where I grew up. Mentor is my home, and I've always found Mentor to be a kind place full of kind people. 2 years ago, I became involved in animal rescue. I foster dogs, and I bottle feed kittens. I have worked with TNR groups and rescue groups in Lake County and in surrounding counties. Last year, I personally took in 49 kittens. 37 of those were from feral colonies. That's 37 kittens that got adopted, 37 kittens that won't grow up feral. I respectfully ask for you to listen to the TNR groups that manage colonies successfully and to consider letting them do what they do. I ask you to look at the city of Willowick and how well their program is working for them. I ask you to let us continue to do this work together. These groups are offering us a great opportunity to improve our community. They have the resources, the volunteers, and the knowledge to teach us how to properly manage these colonies. Let's get in front of this and accept the help these groups are offering to our great and kind city. Thank you for allowing me to speak tonight.
Next, we have Anthony Fiorello.
Hello. My name is Anthony Fiorello. I'm representing Willowick Community Cats. I'm the president of the organization. And I'm also I'm employed in the city of Mentor. I just wanted to share with you some of the background that went into the ordinance that was created in Willowick. It was very similar to a lot of different cities that have dealt with neighborhood or neighbor issues with feeding stray and feral cats. There was a number of organizations that attended the reading of the ordinance. We stood up. We proposed putting together a committee with the city council and the mayor to sit down and talk about, help to educate the council and the mayor on the benefits of a TNR program. We have great leadership in Willowick, as the city of Mentor has wonderful leadership. They took a very proactive, responsible approach to sit down. Mayor Bondi, who has recently passed, but was a wonderful mayor, and he took it upon himself to start the process of bringing those groups together. We sat down, we discussed, we came up with a plan. We came up with an alternative to the ordinance that they had proposed, which has been very effective. I can just share with you that we started off with 13 registered colonies with the Willowick Community Cat Organization. We're down to 10. Many of those colonies have reduced their populations and are still being managed by a responsible managed caregiver. Those cats are also sterilized today. Sometimes we do see people dropping their stray cats off within those colonies. But it gives us an opportunity to identify those stray-friendly cats, trap them, and then find them homes. These are social animals. We have lots of people that are willing to foster or adopt those cats out. And it's a benefit to the community. I can share with you that recently we were called by a resident in Willowick that had a stray cat, friendly stray cat, that was emaciated and came across their path. It was so sick. Lake Humane worked with that person to take in the cat. We helped to bring that cat to Lake Humane. Unfortunately, the cat passed away, right? So what a TNR program also does is it helps to take inventory, give, unfortunately, a place where people who can no longer care for their cat, and that happens, that's a reality, may choose to drop their cat off with, and a managed caregiver would recognize and be able to act on behalf of that cat. I can also tell you that we're involved in a colony in Eastlake. We started off with 20 cats. We tracked the location of those cats, two of them. were lost to attrition and predation. Eight of those were kittens that we trapped and we had socialized and found homes for. In fact, we just adopted out the last one through an organization that we work with. 10 adults were returned. Now we're left with two of those cats, and we've assumed two strays that somebody dumped off in that location, and we're working to trap them and find them homes at this time. So it's a very effective process. The City of Willowick and their leadership was very proactive, and I just encourage you to table this ordinance, work together with these great organizations in Lake Humane to come up with a program that's going to benefit the City of Mentor. Thank you.
Thank you.
Mrs. Dowling.
Yes. Excuse me, Anthony. Anthony, we have in front of us an ordinance number 2015-17 from Willowick that forbids the feeding of
with
nuisance
the exception of working with the TNR organization.
Okay, so.
All right. With the exception of working with the TNR organization,
okay,
that's registered with the city.
Where this flyer came about, where they changed the ordinance around and including this with.
Yeah, it was a full ban. And then again, we worked with the city to come up with letting the organization manage the program.
Okay.
It costs the city nothing. They don't have to put in any resources or any money. The organizations we work with the caregivers, we fundraise, and the program has been very successful.
Okay, makes more sense now. Thank you for the information. Okay.
Thank you for that clarification. next, we have John Viviani.
Thank you. I can tell I'm not going to be very popular in here. I've lived in Mentor for 24 years, and what I can tell you is feral cats are not pets. People confuse that, okay? We have ordinances for dogs. You have an ordinance for a dog anything, a dog going to the bathroom, a dog not on a leash, a dog barking. There's nothing for cats, okay? Now, I walk down the sidewalk of my street, and you know what the sidewalk in my street's covered with? Cat poop. On the sidewalk, all over the street, okay? Next to the sidewalk. When I walk my dog, it's a constant battle of pulling the leash to pull the dog away from the cat poop. Now here, you know, we have people come up and say that it doesn't spread disease, okay? These are all my medical bills. Okay, page upon page upon page from my dog getting worms from eating cat poop. Okay? Now, every day these cats poop in my yard. Every day. My yard, the neighbor's yard, the whole neighborhood. There's 30 cats up the street. They go to the bathroom twice a day. That's 20,000 cat poops within, I'd say, a quarter mile of these houses where they feed them. It's everywhere. Okay, my joys in life are simple. I like walking the dog. I like playing with the dog in the backyard. I go out, I throw the frisbee. Dog brings it back. Throw the frisbee. Dog brings it back. Throw the frisbee. Dog brings it back. Fourth time, dog takes off right to the cat poop. My dog eats cat poop every day. Okay, that's no quality of life for me. The other thing I enjoyed was having a garden. Now, I didn't have a problem with the deer. Okay, I could put something out to keep the deer out of my garden, okay? I can't keep the cats out of my garden. The cats ruin my garden. Every day in my garden, cat poop. No, I had a great garden. Best tomatoes ever, best bean. Everyone told me, your stuff's the best. I don't have a garden anymore, okay? They ruin that for me. No one cares about me. No one cares about my dog's health. No one cares about anything, okay? And so they say, doesn't spread disease. Well, it does spread disease, right here. My dog, okay, 20% of the adult population test positive for worms. Where do they get that from? From handling a dog? I don't know. You know, there's some connection there. But we get into this further. They spread disease. You know, we talk about toxoplasmosis, rabies, etc., worms, okay? But what they do is they tell you, oh, if you don't feed them, they don't kill animals because we feed them. Well, that's not true. They kill animals anyway. That's what they do. They're hunters. There's plenty of studies here. I have studies from Australia. 29 animal extinctions in Australia from feral cats. Okay? In Hawaii, they're killing the seals, the state bird they're killing. Okay? Now, we also have from the Smithsonian here, feral cats kill billions of small critters every year. It's what they do. Okay? Now, I'm not going to get into their websites, these websites. What I ask you is read up on this and educate yourself. Okay, so TNR doesn't solve my problems because the cat poop's still there. They're still going around killing everything all day long. Okay, and then I'll get into TNR also because the ladies that feed them up the street told me they were doing TNR. Yet every year, there's three or four new litters. Every year. Every year, there's 20 or 30 new cats. Every year. They tell me they trap them, they this, they that, they're doing all this stuff. Problem's never solved. They disappear. You know, some get hit by cars, coyotes get them, et cetera. I don't know what happens. But every 3 months, here's a new litter. And it just goes on and on and on. And it's been like this for how many years? And my other point is there's 52,000 people in Mentor. And the ones I talk to agree with me. You have an organized group here. They're on the social media. Most of them aren't from Mentor. Okay, they're on the social media, they're all here tonight, and the next city that brings us up, they're all going to be there saying the same thing, TNR, TNR, TNR. You know, they're not from Mentor, and if the 52,000 people in Mentor were educated on this problem, they would tell you they don't want the cats fed. Now, three houses down from me, a young man just moved in with his wife. He comes up to me, he says, you know, I picked up 20 cat poops in my front yard. I said, welcome to the neighborhood. He was cleaning the leaves off the side of his house. He told me the smell would have knocked you out. He said when he was done, he was going to throw his clothes away. Throw his gloves, clothes, everything in the garbage. That's my neighborhood. That's what I deal with. So, you know, they can talk all they want about not spreading disease. They do spread disease, okay? They do kill things. That's what they do, okay? The right thing, if you don't feed them, they're not around. The lady up the street, there's a colony there, and there's a colony where she works. Do you think that's a coincidence? You put the food out, and they'll come. They smell the feces. They smell the food. They smell other cats. They come for miles, and you never get them all. You never get the tomcats. You don't catch them all, and they reproduce, and this goes on forever and ever. The only thing to do is to stop feeding them, plain and simple. Stop feeding them. Let me have my neighborhood back. Let me be able to walk down the street. Let me not have these medical bills, okay, that I get every 3 months, okay? Sorry for being a little vocal, but that's what I deal with. Thank you.
The next speaker is Judy Militia.
Hi, my name is Judy Militia, and I do TNR in Painesville. Me and my husband right now in Painesville have 15 cats because they were just given to us from the flood. I believe in TNR 100%. I'm involved in a colony in Painesville where I rescued 8 different cats. 2 of them were just dropped off by the apartment complex, and I took them to a shelter where I do volunteer, and I think it's so important that we do this to educate people that there are places out there that you can bring cats. They can help it that people abandon them, drop them off at different places off on the street, on the streets, at different apartment complexes, wherever. They don't want to live on the streets, but I believe not feeding them is not the right answer. I think educating everybody on TNR, pulling together for the communities and stuff like that, and showing the right way to take care of cats. I love cats. I will always take care of them. My husband loves them very much. We take care of them all the time, but I do this on my own. I don't ask for any help, no money whatsoever. I do feed them. I've there's a colony in Wycliffe. I do the same thing. I trap, neuter, release them. There was 5 kittens. I took care of them. They all passed away because they were not well taken care of. I just so believe in TNR and people helping each other, pulling together as a community to help these feral cats. I don't believe that they want to live out there. I don't think that they deserve not to be fed. Where are they supposed to go for food? Are they supposed to go into the garbage cans? And then we'll pick up on diseases. And that's all I have to say. Thank you.
Thank you.
Next, we have James Rickott, R-I-C-K-O-T.
My name is James Rickett, and I do live in the city of Mentor. About 5 years ago, we live over on Lynx. We had about 20, 25 cats that would come in the yard. I was a dick. I'd let my little 12-pound Yorkie poo out to chase him out of my yard, never thinking he could get his butt kicked by those cats because they were feral. They were street cats. Did that for a couple years, and then I started thinking, they're coming here for a reason. They obviously didn't just sprout up out of the ground. We live across from the golf course, so talking to some of the neighbors, we found out basically people would just drop them off at the golf course. Convenient. They didn't have to do anything with them after that. We started trapping, spaying, neuter, releasing. I'm not affiliated with the group, but Kathy Esposito and her sister, Margaret, were very instrumental in helping us to do this, and we've gone now from 20 to 25 cats coming into our yard to 6 that come on a fairly regular basis. So I'm coming at it from a different perspective. I used to be basically a dick toward the cats. I was not a cat person, lifting them up and stuff. Had a little dog. He did us fine. Well, now we have 2 little dogs and 2 kittens that we took from their feral hood, and they're living in the hood inside where life is good. We've taken, I believe it's, and I'll get corrected later, she'll correct me on anything I did said wrong up here, but I believe we've trapped, spayed, neutered, and released 21 adults, and we've also gotten 18 kittens off the street. Personally, and this is just an aside, I'm more concerned about the coyotes that I see cutting across my street and yipping out there nightly and in the morning than I am about feral cats. Coyotes will attack my dog. They will kill my dog. Coyotes will attack people. I'm not here to argue with people. I have friends that are hunters. And I believe that the solution is to trap, spay, neuter, and release, because I've seen the population deplete in our own yard. That's all I have to say. Thank you very much.
Next speaker is Janet Reed.
My name is Janet Reed, and I live in the city of Mentor. I do not agree that the way to reduce and control the overpopulation of feral and free-roaming cats in the city is to add them to the list of nuisance health risk animals. Adding the cats as a nuisance animal may actually interfere with the most effective and humane method to control and reduce free roaming cats, which is TNR, trap, neuter, and return. The free roaming and feral cat populations are the result of human actions. The source of the issue is people not spaying and neutering pets and then allowing them to roam or abandoning them completely outside. The overpopulation has taken many years to develop. It's going to take some time to get it under control. An important part of a successful TNR program is working with the caregivers of feral cat colonies. These compassionate people care about the cats in their colonies and do not want to put them in harm's way. Trust between caregivers and any successful TNR program is essential. Labeling feral cats as a nuisance will discourage cooperation by feral cat givers. We have knowledgeable, dedicated people in Lake County that can work together to get the cat overpopulation under control and manner. Do not pass Ordinance 17-08. Instead, work with Mentor Community Cats, Pet Fix, Lake Humane, and the many dedicated and compassionate people who live in Mentor to develop and implement a trap-neuter return program. Not only will a well-planned TNR program reduce and control the free-roaming population, the program can also be a model for other communities in Lake County. Thank you.
Sarah Pitchler.
Good evening. My name is Sarah Pitchler, and I'm here representing the organization PetFix. I currently work as a vet assistant and a receptionist there, and I have a letter here from our executive director just to pledge our support for the TNR program. We currently have a TNR program at our facility, and we work with a lot of these organizations that are here tonight in spaying and neutering these animals. I personally have been involved in TNR for over 6 years. I worked as the TNR coordinator at the Cleveland APL until I had my daughter, and now I work at PetFix. So I've worked with many, many, many caregivers and seen that the attrition of these cats go down. And then the problems, there's the city of Cleveland. If you want even more information, talking to the city of Cleveland, they help provide money and funding for it, and it has really helped the number of cats that they see in the city of Cleveland. But as far as PetFix goes, in the past 10 years, we provided 55,000 surgeries for pet animals and feral cats, and we've hopefully prevented over 500,000 kittens and puppies to be born. Our program for the specific feral cats with PetFix is a total of $31 per cat. It's $25 for the surgery and then $6 for the rabies vaccine. And we do that for any caregiver of a feral cat if they come in a trap or in a carrier, and you do not have to have an appointment for that. And then we are also willing to do a transport program. I know I just talked to a resident here tonight that wants to try to do a transport program for his area. So we have a van. We can drive out and pick up groups of cats if people can trap them, and we can bring them in and get them fixed that way too. So we're happy to help in any way that we can, and I'd like to pass this information along to council if I can also.
Certainly.
Thank you.
Next speaker is Karen Brennan Griffith.
Hi, I just want to share my story. I don't really belong to any of the organizations, but I will probably after today. I was on my own, and I wanted to say that I believe in TNR. I trapped and neutered over 80 cats in Grand River from a time period of December of 14 to May of 15. And to date, there's probably about 30 of those cats remain through attrition. The cats have gone away by either getting hit by cars, coyote, disease. They run off. They don't come back. I don't know. But I just wanted to support TNR because I myself can vouch that it works. And what was I going to say? And I can say that all the cats that I've known, I've never been scratched or bitten by one. These cats are terrified of people for the most part. And you can go by, I can take you to my colony, and you'll see that you come up on them, and they're just going to run away from you. They will not attack a person unless they were diseased and they had rabies or something like that. And most of the cats I have been all vaccinated. And I took them to the APL to get them fixed. They were all vaccinated with rabies, et cetera. And any of the cats, and somebody like myself, as long as I'm there to be the caretaker, I can watch for any cats that get dumped. And the minute I see somebody dump a cat, I don't see who does it, but once there's a friendly cat show up, I know somebody dumped it, and I immediately take it off to get it fixed, and then I can adopt that one out. More, all of the ones like that I have adopted out, and I really hadn't had an issue with it. But where they're at, people find out where your colonies are, so you really need somebody who's there day in and day out to see any of these cats that get dumped. And those are the problem cats you got to keep an eye on, and your colony will go down. I'm proof of that. And what else I want to say? I wasn't prepared to talk, so I'm just kind of winging it. I didn't think what else comments were said. And I agree that the cats, I rarely see cat poop. They bury it. Where I'm at, they're by the water, so a lot of them bury their feces in the sand and stuff like that. I just wanted to tell you that TNR does work, and I'm proof of that. and I paid for it all in my pocket. And anyone in Menor that needs help with it, I'm here to help.
Thank you.
April Haviland.
How are you guys doing tonight?
Thank you.
My name's April Haviland. I'm the current president of Menor Community Cats. And I did want to take a moment just to thank the council for facilitating some open discussion around what we clearly can see as a passionate issues for many residents within Lake County, including many that do make up your constituents. Menor Community Cats was founded in August 2015 because there was a need for implemented targeted trap neuter return programs within city limits and the surrounding neighborhoods. We have people that reach out to us when a mother cat takes refuge under their deck, when a hungry stray is begging at the back door for food, and yes, when well-intentioned feeding does go awry. We've been working tirelessly since our inception, and in 2016, we were able to help 615 needy animals out of that 900 that Cindy did mention earlier. 60% of those cats were fixed, vaccinated, and returned, and the other 40% were adopted. So that is 270 cats approximately and kittens that are no longer on your streets. Together, we've worked on 21 separate colonies within Menor alone, which is about half of our total workload from 2016. One thing that I would like to mention that hasn't come up yet is that Menor Community Cats consists of 6 members. So you can imagine what we could do with a few more people or the support of some local legislators. All humor aside, passing a feeding ban will exacerbate overpopulation and bring more issues to fruition, not resolution. We urge the council to reconsider the proposed legislation in favor of finding a solution that better serves both the two-legged and four-legged residents of Menor, Ohio. Thank you.
Next speaker is Tabitha Sias, S-I-A-S.
That's right. That's impressive.
Good guess.
Hello, my name is Tabitha Sias. I'm a member of the Together Initiative for Ohio Community Cats. As you can see, this is a big issue in Ohio. And unfortunately, we're a little late to the game compared to other states. But there's a lot of organizations who are fighting hard to show city councilmen and organizations that, unfortunately, even if you aren't a fan of cats, feeding bans do not work. They're not scientifically supported. They actually cause cats to come out more often. So I feel even if you are concerned about feral cats, proposing a feeding ban is really just covering up the issue and not treating it. And unfortunately, it won't work. And even if you aren't a fan of cats, you should love TNR because it causes less cats to happen. So TNR is a win-win for people who hate cats because I'm sure, unfortunately, you have to deal with some of your constituents who are not fans of cats. So TNR is a win-win for people who love cats and don't love cats. Another thing I wanted to touch on, I'm a registered veterinary technician, and I'm hearing a lot of false information regarding cats spreading diseases. And I understand from a human aspect, because I've talked to human doctors, they have a very different perspective. I just wanted to touch base on toxoplasmosis just a smidge scientifically. Because I know you guys had some concerns about that as a council, which I completely understand from a human aspect. And as far as rabies, as TNR programs endorse rabies vaccines, and the last case of a cat transmitting rabies to a human was in 1972. And that's the most recent figures I've gotten from the Ohio State of Agriculture. So that's just something I ask them on a regular basis for things like this. So I just wanted to touch base a little bit about toxoplasmosis. So the leading cause of toxoplasmosis in humans is through the ingestion of undercooked meat. It's not cats. This is a really common myth that I come across, unfortunately, so I'm very passionate about it. Direct contact with cats is not considered to be a risk factor for toxoplasmosis infection in people, and this is information from the Companion Animal Parasite Council, which is essentially the CDC for animals. So we tend to keep track of how human zoonotic diseases affect animals and us a lot more than human medicine per se. Toxoplasmosis is transmitted to humans from cats when a human accidentally swallows the parasite through contact with cat feces that contain toxoplasmosis. So the thing is with toxoplasmosis, cats only shed the organism for a few days in their entire life. So for a human, just to break it down, for a human to obtain toxoplasmosis from a cat, they would have to somehow obtain the feces. I know I'm getting into details, but obtain the feces from the cat, which cats are very malignant cleaners. So that's unlikely that they would have dried feces on them. It would have to be on them for 2 days. It would have to be the 1 to 10 days that they shed it their entire life, and they would have to ingest it. So I just wanted to just nip that right in the bud, just because as a veterinary technician with a lot of knowledge, I hear a lot of myths about cat diseases as a way to kind of promote feeding bans and other negative things. So I actually have a lot of wonderful information here with Companion Animal Parasite Council figures, because there is a lot of information on the internet. We all know you can find, really, unfortunately, whatever you want. So I like the CAPC because it's essentially the animal form of the CDC. So I feel it's a very reliable resource. So I just wanted to touch on that. It's barely impossible to get toxoplasmosis from a cat. And as far as dogs obtaining parasites from cat feces, we recommend year-round prevention for heartworm and parasite prevention for dogs all year round, because they live in the soil. That's not really a cat issue. Parasites live in the soil, which is why, as you guys know, your veterinarians recommend year-round prevention for parasites and heartworm. So I just wanted to throw that out there. That's all.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Okay, next we have Kira Pilat or Pile.
Good evening. I will try my best to be brief, and I hope I'm bringing everything together. My name is Kira Pilot. I'm not from Mentor, although I love Mentor. I traveled here from the Cuyahoga-Lorain border. It's that important to me that I wanted to share my views. I just, for us animal lovers and for citizens, we've brought up all kinds of, we could do a symposium. We've talked about toughening laws against animal abandoners, against the dangers of toxoplasmosis, the origins of feline overpopulation, and what happens. And I like the man from Mentor, I wouldn't want cat poop in my yard, and nor my dog getting sick either. What it seems to me, City Council, just the bottom line, TNR will affect feline overpopulation. We're not getting together to feed cats to discuss the upcoming Trump inauguration and, you know, my latest spin class. We're doing it. I wrote this down. I'm a little nervous. Feeding leads to trapping, and the trapping leads to neutering. And then the current colonies that are there will be maintained with the feeding, but we're not creating more. Except for, again, when we're leaving food out for trapping. So I would say to the animal lover and to the non-animal lovers and citizens, you cannot lose with TNR. I only found out about this meeting the other day. I'm sure my colleagues, there's studies from, I know the city of Phoenix, there's been major urban and suburban areas where feline overpopulation has decreased significantly, 50 to 70% with TNR. That's all. We're not doing it because we feel sorry for the cats or have psychological issues of our own where we think we need to feed animals. We're doing it for the community to decrease feline overpopulation. Thank you.
Thank you. Renee Slattery.
Very much. I don't know if I can say anything more than my colleagues have so eloquently spoken about. I can only say that I really don't belong to any particular organization here. I started TNR about 6 years ago in Cuyahoga County and trapped 117 cats in a year in Cuyahoga County. A business owner and Mentor, by the way, I'm from Mentor, and my husband and I have a business in Mentor. A business owner and Mentor heard that I do this, and I only do it myself, and asked me if I would help him because he had about 15 cats on his property. He loved them, but he asked if I would help them reduce, there were a lot of babies being born. So I started about 3 years ago. I trapped 15 cats on his property alone in a 32-day period, and today that exact same population is down to 6. They die off. Cats in the wild don't live that long. I feed them religiously every day, along with some of my friends. And in addition to that colony, I have another colony in Mentor, a woman who had, she wasn't being responsible. Everybody should really be responsible when it comes to feral cats and trap, spay, neuter, and release. But she didn't know how to do it, and she asked me if I would help her. There were 67 cats on her property. I trapped every single one of them. Every one of them, and we built on her property a gigantic, what we call a hotel. And the cats live in there, and they'll live until, you know, until they die off naturally. But I know it works. I've seen it work. By inducing a feeding ban, people aren't going to stop feeding. People who are passionate, like these people are just going to sneak and feed them at different times. I know I would. I'm sorry. I'm just going to admit it. But it's just, you know, it's the right thing to do. As far as diseases coming from cats, I've never once gotten scratched or bit by feral cats. I've had very feral cats in traps. Never have they, like everybody says, they run from you. They're not running to you. They're going to run away from you. We're lucky when we can trap them. And I've spent all my own money. I've never asked for a dime. It's cost me thousands and thousands of dollars. But I'm very passionate about it. I know that's the answer. By starving these cats, that's not going to do it. They're only going to start eating. They're going to go after birds. They're going to go after chipmunks, and they're going to get diseases. So, and that's where the real problem will sit in. But we're so lucky to have the people that we have here in Mentor that care so much. And I'm tickled to see all the people that are, it just warms my heart, and I'm so glad that I came here tonight, because it's just really the important thing to do and the right thing to do. I don't think anybody wants to kill animals. I mean, does anybody really want to do that? You know? So that's all I have to say. Thank you for letting me speak. I appreciate it.
Okay. Catherine Sposito.
Hi, my name is Kathy Sposito. I've been a Mentor resident for almost 10 years now. I'm also a member of Mentor Community Cats, and I have a unique perspective from the street level because I'm the one actually out there with the traps, trapping them and transporting. I've transported 500 cats the last 2 years for spay neuter, so I know what this is about. So I'm the one who gets to work with the residents, and I have the joy of seeing what happens with TNR. What happens, you know, everyone's happier. The cats are happier. They're healthier. They're fixed. They're vaccinated. They're not fighting. They're not spraying. The nuisance behavior is decreased. People on the street are happier. There's not as many cats running around. The population is significantly decreased. We're pulling kittens off the street. It's just, it's amazing to see this actually work. You can talk about it all you want, but actually to see it work. And I would be happy to take you to many places, Mentor, Lake County, all over, and show you exactly what has happened and what we've done, the numbers, and to talk to the people this actually affects. I would be happy to do that. There's so many great stories for this. So it actually works. I'm here to tell you it works. That's all. And also the gentleman that is having a problem with the cats by his house, I understand that, you know, you have cat poop and whatever the problems are. I understand that. And I personally would be happy to come and help catch the rest of those cats. And I have other people who will help me also. We'd be happy to help you because we don't want you to be unhappy either. We want everyone to have a good solution to this problem. So, all right, thank you. Thank you.
Well, that was our final speaker, Council.
I have a question.
talk a lot about the colonies here, and how do you identify, you know, does someone call you, or does the city, maybe someone from the city or the county calls and tells, like, Mentor community, we got a problem, and then you knock on someone's door and ask them if they need help, or...
Right, did you want someone from Mentor Community Cats?
You could, yeah, sure.
Did you want to come up and address the question?
Would you like your pen back?
I mean, it's a nice pen. If you'll vote in my favor, you can keep it. So.
Wow, you're special, John.
anyway. So we typically see, we got our website up and running probably about 4 or 5 months after we were officially incorporated under Community Cat Companions. Typically, we get mostly phone calls, I would say, but we do get a lot of emails. We are now on Facebook, so we get those as well. We do have a contact us form on the website, but that doesn't seem to get as many. And I will tell you this year, a big change that we've seen is people will call Lake Humane asking for help with feral cats, and they give them our information. So we've actually seen a spike from that as well.
So let me ask you this. If you've got someone who's resisting help, for instance, but the neighbor calls you to say, you know, my neighbor next door has got all these cats, will you assist that person as well to trap those cats?
So if it's a neighbor calling about someone else, typically we don't just go onto someone's property without permission, so we couldn't sneak onto the caregiver's property and do anything. However, we'd be more than happy to speak to the caregiver about TNR, the benefits, and talk to them about how we can help, why they should fix them, because as much as people like kittens after the second or third litter, I'm sure everybody feels a little overwhelmed. But yes, we try to bridge the gaps and keep neighbors happy and
Would you go on that person that was complaining about the neighbor's property and set traps? Would you go up there so residents at home?
We have run into people who, for various irrational reasons, are reluctant to TNR their own cats. Generally, we can talk logic to them. I've inherited a lot of those people. I had a woman who resisted for 2 years before she met me. Her cat colony went up to, I think, 18 in her backyard, and by then she was easy prey for me to talk logic to. But another point is that if a person absolutely refuses to have the cats that they are feeding TNR'd, and their neighbor is willing to allow us to put traps on that property, we can legally do that. These cats do not belong to the person who is feeding them. And in that situation, I at least would step in and go to the neighbor and try to get things under control before there are 18 or 30 or 100 cats.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Madam President.
Mr. Blake.
You know, and I'm glad everybody's here to discuss this, but the thing I keep asking myself is, how big of a problem is this in Mentor? I'm through my ward every week. I can't say as I really see cats. I can't see them moving about in the summertime. I don't think I've received a call about feral cats. I know I have one colony that I talked to one of the neighbors today, and it seems to be shrinking, possibly. So do we have any numbers on cats? How big of a problem is this in Mentor? Anybody?
Yeah, Councilman Blake, I think the problem that we see is that we have, in terms of numbers, mm-hmm. you're not talking about a huge volume of calls, but by the same token, the question is not the volume, it's really how to effectively manage those calls that we do get. I think, unfortunately, a lot of our residents will be reluctant to make a call because they know we have no effective means to manage that issue. Mm-hmm. So we don't get a lot of barking dog calls either, but we have a means in which to address those, and I think that's really what some of the council and administration were after, is just trying to find a way to find the best way to manage those problems when they do arise. And I think, like a lot of other bits of legislation or community issues, once it comes to light in discussions like this, we find that there are a lot of folks who will weigh in at that point and say, yes, I have a problem. Glad to hear that there's a solution. So in terms of volume, it's not huge.
Because the only emails that I've got lately are from, you know, the TNR people and from people who do not want us to pass this legislation and stop feeding or prevent the feeding of cats. So I'm trying to get a sense of, you know, how big of a problem this is. Is it a growing problem? Are we seeing more cats causing more problems? That's what I'm trying to determine. I mean, do we have enough of a problem that TNR program would be something that we'd invest in or look into investing in? I don't know. I think I have somebody to answer that question. and hopefully she's done an aerial count.
A lot of the points that were just made are the ones that we're dealing with. We can tell you how many calls we get and how many we've seen, but there's a stigma attached to it. A lot of places do have feeding bans, so many of those people won't come forward. I can tell you that we were founded last year in our August of 2015, mainly focused on one colony, and I believe between all of us, we TNR'd about 100 cats. Mm-hmm. So this year we're up to 615. So I believe as people learn more about our organizations and what we do and that we do have these services, we will get more calls, which might be an argument maybe to consider a policy similar to Willowick, because then you have three organizations that are willing to track these numbers for you, and you're not just making a blind assumption or guess.
Is that 600 cats in Menor, TNR'd?
615 cats for Menor Community Cats, and half of those colonies were in Menor, so we'll say at least 300, okay. Depending on how the...
Over what period of time?
All of 2016.
Oh,
if you'd be interested, though, we do have a colony tracker spreadsheet where we date how many cats are from what area, when they were found kittens, et cetera. So we do have that information that's more. I don't know everything off the top of my head, but I will tell you what I do know and give you the spreadsheet afterwards.
Okay.
If you want more information.
Thank you. I think you've answered my question. Thanks.
I just wanted to add something. If you, Menor is one of the groups. The other two are in Willowick and Eastlake, and they are not handled in the same way. Willowick has the ordinance that we are tied to. We are the group that's charged with all cat issues. The city does have recourse if colony caregivers are not following it, and it's not just spaying and neutering. There are other things that they have to do in order to be in compliance with the ordinance. We've really had no problems. Eastlake is a little different. There's no ordinance. There's nothing that says that you can't feed them. We're not tied to it. However, every call that comes into the city of Eastlake is immediately referred to us. They don't deal with cat issues at all in Willowick or Eastlake. We handle everything in those two cities, you know, our respective groups. So I don't know what you are looking to doing. I'd like to talk more about it, but you don't necessarily have to start any kind of a program on your own, but you do have an organization that you can refer to. Thanks.
Thank you.
There's no other questions. I'll move to put this on first reading.
Second.
Well, Mr. Mayor. I just want to make a comment. We've been given a lot of information tonight. I learned a lot about cats, more than I ever knew about cats. And you know, one of the things that was brought up was the toxoplasmosis. And, you find all kinds of different reports on that. I mean, the internet's loaded with them. And my mother since passed away. She died of non-Hodgkin's lymphoma. But at the point, she was scratched by a cat, and that's what her doctors were telling her, that it affected her immune system so much that they felt it brought on the lymphoma. So you believe them? I don't know. I mean, she passed away from non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, you know. So she's dead, she's gone. But there's a lot of different reports, and at the time, you did a lot of research on it and tried to talk to different doctors and different things. So when you're looking at that aspect of it, be careful what you read and what you see, because I know, for one, from trying to do my research on it, my wife trying to do her research on it, my father, you know, there's very different conflicting reports, but that's what we were told.
I'm really loud already, so. That resident can't hear you.
So I see this happen a lot with cats and city council, because you guys are worried about your constituents. I'm sure you're worried about the cats as well. But first things first is the people of Mentor. So I see there's a lot of false information regarding disease transmission. I mean, like toxoplasmosis, because we have owners come to us that are pregnant and their doctors told them this, and then we're like, oh gosh, okay, wonderful. Don't want to discredit what your doctor said, but here's facts. So I would be more than happy as a veterinary professional, and I can get some veterinarians to help with this in any way to clear up anything, and they wouldn't be just blogs, because unfortunately, people send blogs and read blogs and they read false information. I actually have scientific studies and CAPC. I think CAPC is a wonderful resource for you guys that's reliable, similar to the CDC. That's one of the only reliable resources online that I can think of off the top of my head. That's kind of how much false information is out there. So from a council perspective, I know you guys have a lot of other things to worry about, and I understand that you can spend hours researching how zoonotic cat diseases are. So I would be happy. I'm emailing the information I talked to you guys about today to the council members' emails I have, but I would be happy to answer any questions or get any other, like the state veterinarians on board, just to have, and then you can tell your constituents, we have veterinarians who are saying, we have like medical documentation, we have human doctors, because you're gonna have a few constituents that are probably going to give you difficulty and say, but toxoplasmosis, but rabies. So you can actually give them resources that are true and not a blog or a random thing that they were told in passing. So it's something that you guys, I can provide you with those resources so you can just send those to those people so you don't have to worry about it. That's just something I wanted.
Are you saying CAT? See, what is the website?
Oh, CAPC. So it's the Companion Animal Parasite Council. There's tons of information on there, but there's actually, it's similar to the CDC. So it's just for animal parasites, though. Okay. So they talk a lot about zoonotic potential, because as veterinary professionals, we also are, we want to protect humans, because we want to continue to increase that human-animal bond, and we don't want humans getting sick from animals. So that's something we actually follow very closely.
Okay. A lot. If you want to email, you can just send to citycouncil@cityofmentor.com.
Oh, yeah, I can definitely.
And then we all receive it, so you don't have.
Oh, that's even better. Thank
you. It's so much easier to do it that way,
okay,
and then
wonderful.
We'll all receive it.
I will definitely do that as soon as I leave. And then, if you guys have any questions, I have the state veterinarians. I have a lot of people on board that have been helping me through this, because this is a constant struggle that I see that council members have to deal with. So I have a lot of great resources.
Okay.
For that.
Thank you.
Yes,
we have a motion on the floor.
Second.
Please call the roll. Mr. Marm?
Yes.
Mr. Blake?
Yes.
Mr. Donovan?
Yes.
Mrs. Dowling?
Yes.
Mr. Kirshner?
Yes.
Mr. Krieger?
Yes.
Mr. Landig?
Yes.
Ordinance number 17-0-08 will go to second reading. We have ordinance number 17-0-09.
An ordinance authorizing the execution and delivery of an economic development grant with Citywide Solutions, Inc., and declaring an emergency.
Mr. Filippia.
Thank you, Madam President, members of council. We're pleased to be able to bring you yet another new client who is prepared to do business in our community. And Mr. Traub, could you offer some details, please?
Thank you, Mr. Filippia. Members of council, you have a staff report that briefly summarizes the information that has been supplied by Citywide Solutions, Inc. I'll briefly summarize. They currently have offices in Dublin and Concord, Ohio. They have done very well in terms of their business model. They provide surveillance systems, access controls, intrusion detection, gate automation and parking revenue control equipment, et cetera, and they both design and install these systems. They have purchased a building at 6801 Hopkins Road, which is at the corner of Hopkins and Osborne. They're going to utilize this facility as their corporate headquarters, sales office, and for service and distribution. You'll note from the financial information that they have supplied, they have enjoyed significant growth from being a rather small business. They are proposing to invest almost $250,000 in terms of this operation, and perhaps more importantly, we'll be moving 11 employees to this new facility in a payroll of approximately $500,000. They've indicated some projections relative to future employment and payroll growth, and that is included in the staff report as well. Utilizing our criteria for Mentor economic development grants, they would qualify for a one-time grant of $10,000 to assist in their move and some building improvements. Thank you.
Gentlemen.
Move to suspend.
Second.
Please call the roll. Mr. Marn?
Yes.
Mr. Blake?
Yes.
Mr. Donovan?
Yes.
Mrs. Dowling?
Yes.
Mr. Kirshner?
Yes.
Mr. Krieger?
Yes.
Mr. Landy?
Yes.
Move for passage.
Second. Second.
Please call the roll. Mr. Marn?
Yes.
Mr. Blake?
Yes.
Mr. Donovan?
Yes.
Mrs. Dowling?
Yes.
Mr. Kirshner?
Yes.
Mr. Krieger?
Yes.
Mr. Landy?
Yes.
Ordinance number 17-0-09 has been adopted. Resolution number 17-R-103.
A resolution approving the transfer of a liquor permit.
Move to approve.
Second.
Please call the roll. Mr. Marn?
Yes.
Mr. Blake?
Yes.
Mr. Donovan?
Yes.
Mrs. Dowling?
Yes.
Mr. Kirshner?
Yes.
Mr. Krieger?
Yes.
Mr. Landig?
Yes.
Resolution 17-R-103 has been approved. Excuse me, my voice is. Second readings, we have none. Third readings, we have none. Manager's report.
Thank you, Council.
You lost half your audience.
Oh, that's okay.
He won't cut the report.
They don't like what you're going to say, apparently.
I'll be brief, by the way.
Say that every time.
Council, we have two pavement open cut requests that we ask for your approval on. Dominion East is asking for a cut to provide gas service at 8655 Market Street.
Move to approve.
Second.
Please call the roll. Mr. Marn?
Yes.
Mr. Blake?
Yes.
Mr. Donovan?
Yes.
Mrs. Dowling?
Yes.
Mr. Kirshner?
Yes.
Mr. Krieger?
Yes.
Mr. Landig?
Yes.
Thank you, Council. And the second is for a request from Land Design for work related to sanitary service connection at 9571 Mentor Avenue.
So moved.
Second.
Please call the roll. Mr. Marn?
Yes.
Mr. Blake?
Yes.
Mr. Donovan?
Yes.
Mrs. Dowling?
Yes.
Mr. Kirshner?
Yes.
Mr. Krieger?
Yes.
Mr. Landig?
Yes.
Thank you, Council. For the third year in a row, the Mentor Police Department has been awarded an OCJS grant of $12,000 to continue the very successful retail theft deterrence program. This will be the fourth year that we've conducted the program, and the grant is used to combat organized retail theft rings and to suppress how they are related to links to drug trafficking and use, especially the opiate abuse problem that we're seeing. The program includes surveillance, undercover police officers, and online database, as well as cooperation and education that we coordinate with retailers. On Wednesday, January 18th, WOIO Cleveland 19 News is scheduled to film the Mentor Fire Department's dive team at the Mentor Lagoons. The segment is to show Channel 19 viewers what kind of conditions our dive teams face when they are called to respond to above and below water emergencies, focusing on our fire department's response capabilities. The segment is scheduled to air during their 11 p.m. newscast on Wednesday, January 18th. On Thursday, January 12th, the council is aware that we received over 2 inches of rain in about a 12-hour period. This was equivalent to about a 5-year frequency storm event. We responded to about 50 concerns citywide as a result of the storm. Most of those dealt with leaf and debris blockages of storm grates and things in the roadway. In fact, about 30 of those 50 resulted in ponding water in the roads or yards, and our crews were able to provide relief to those relatively quickly. The receiving streams were mostly at capacity citywide. Prior to, due to recent rains prior to that and the snow melt, and as well as the semi-permeable conditions because of the frozen ground, this five-year event is probably something closer to a 10-year event overall is how we would factor it. We only had two storm-related basement backups to speak of, and those were associated with a pipe that was damaged on Murray Avenue as a result of some Aqua Ohio work. That was actually repaired on Saturday, so as far as we know, that didn't create any additional problems for the people on Murray from the heavy rains that we had today, so we think we're in a pretty good scenario situation there. We did have three sanitary sewer-related backup concerns in the Bellflower-Palmerston area, which we are in close contact with those people, as well as trying to coordinate a response with the Lake County Utilities Department. And that's it.
Madam President?
Short and sweet.
If I could just address Ken's last point. I thought that was pretty good. I mean, we had a five-year storm, and I was out that day. I saw the water going where it should, a few problems. But, you know, my kudos to the service department. Oh, I'm sorry, that's Matt over there. But I thought that I thought things went very well.
Appreciate that, Councilman.
I'm just about finished, but things are great.
I appreciate those comments, and our Public Works Department, our Engineering Department, and really that's an all hands on deck citywide when yeah. we have these type of events. But I will reciprocate in thanking Council, because when we look at how our storm system fared over this last heavy event, we talked about this at budget time, and we're really coming in at the tail end of a five-year commitment we made to doing an extensive cleaning and televising of our entire citywide system, as well as significant ditch cleaning and regrading. And some of the areas that we've traditionally had problems with did very, very well as a result of some of that work. And, you know, that comes with an investment of dollars and a commitment to supporting the work that we do, as well as with our outside contractors to make that happen. So I know we're continuing that commitment, and it's paying off.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Clerk's correspondence. Council was in receipt of the Mentor Municipal Court monthly report for December 2016.
Commission and committee reports. Council's in receipt of the meeting minutes of the Board of Building and Zoning Appeals from December 13th, 2016. Old business?
Well, I could go old. I just wanted to let everybody know that I was here for the feral cats, that ordinance is going to another reading. If you didn't catch it, I know that some people don't catch that, and they panic, but we're going to give ourselves more time to think about that and discuss it and go over all the options we have. I appreciate y'all coming. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Any other comments, gentlemen? Okay, new business. Yes,
thank you, Council President. Spoke with relative to storm that city manager summed up. Spoke with the sanitary engineer, and on his behalf, a joint public service announcement to remind residents that when you have overflow of a shower, a floor drain, a toilet, that is the sanitary sewer system, and they would like residents to call them. We get a lot of cross calls where they'll call the city when the responsibility for that system, and they want to know about backups, is with the county sanitary sewer engineer, and you can call the treatment plant at any time during the day. Likewise, stormwater related, if it's walls in your basement, sump pump related, flooding in the street, that's the storm sewer system, which is owned by the city, as the city manager just detailed the five-year program of cleaning it to help that performance and inspecting it. So those calls should come to the city of Mentor and we share information, and they're interested in calls that we get. But if the residents understand that, they can call the right organization and possibly get prompter service. And in the Bellflower area, where we have historic problems with the sanitary, sanitary engineer reminded me that the trucks, when they come out routinely to pump, when the manhole gets full, they no longer lay the hose to another part of the system, but they use the old underground force main. So that was reported by several. Why aren't they pumping to the other manhole? And I had forgotten too when I was away. So just a reminder to the Bellflower area that they are still doing that. When the pumper truck comes up, it's just running the pump through an underground pipe to the other part of the system when it has capacity to do so, to protect those neighbors that are on the cusp of backup. Thank you.
Gentlemen? Okay, we have two persons that would like to speak before council this evening. The first is Elaine Foster.
Good evening, Madam President, Council Lipiak, Mr. Knight. Appreciate the time tonight.
Speak up a little.
Better?
Much
better.
Thank you.
Okay. All right. Boy, I wish I had that kind of dear Defenders of Ohio could be here tonight. However, I'm here by myself, as far as I know. I'm here tonight to discuss the recent calling in Mentor again that's started back up. I received a letter in the mail that I have here, calling in my neighborhood now, which is just heartbreaking, as you guys, if I could just keep my composure. This doesn't count on the 4 minutes. I did a survey right before you guys bought a property at Dale R. Rice. There were 101 residents who signed a petition saying that they wanted the woods to remain just as it is. And sure enough, as soon as the city gets the woods, culling begins in my neighborhood. There's hunting all around. There's hunting across the street from me. There's hunting in a couple streets over from me. There's hunting in backyards. And you're adding calling to the program. From listening to everybody tonight, there are more cats, feral cats in Mentor than there are deer. And I will tell you that I have a flyover report from March of 2016, and I'm awaiting. I've tried to get the reports from just a couple of weeks ago to no avail. And I will share with you what I have found out, that there are 28.1 square miles in the city of Mentor. Most has been developed. As noted, last year the deer were generally not stirred by the sound or motion. 77 individual deer were counted on the flyover. 77. A multiple confidence percentage rate, values ranging from 50 to 85%. At an 80% confidence rate, the 77 deer that were counted would be representative of a population of 97 deer. Now, there's a margin of error there. I understand that. When you look at when the program started, there's been hundreds and hundreds of deer killed in the city of Mentor. There are numbers that are counted for culling. That doesn't include the numbers. You don't add the numbers together in the culling program that have been hunted or killed in deer car accidents, which has... I watched with interest the news story the other day on when they were talking about the culling in my backyard, and I understood that there were still some major concerns about the deer car accidents, and it's been dropped considerably. When they did the flyover too, the deers that were counted were on the perimeter of Mentor, Kirtland Hills, Concord. They weren't all in the city of Mentor. I am really opposed to this program, and I talked to ODNR, and I asked them to watch very carefully the numbers, because what I'm gathering, what I'm hearing, what I'm seeing, the numbers aren't adding up, and somebody has got to be watching the numbers. The letter that I got for the calling program, and I brought this to the attention of the Mentor Police Department, there were no specific dates, no specific times, and no location. I had to call myself and get that information, which is just preposterous, that the people in these neighborhoods aren't informed directly and honestly. When you did the invocation, honest and fair, be honest with the people of Mentor. I might be the only voice right now. And maybe people are in fear of intimidation. Like I said to you in another council meeting, I've gotten flyers in my doorway. I've been called. I've been getting letters. I liked what one of your council members said about a misdemeanor for the people who drop off cats in Mentor. There's also a first-degree misdemeanor for someone who claps their hands in opposition to an unlawful hunt on a telephone pole. First-degree misdemeanor charges. This program, the culling program in the city of Mentor, is cruel. That's my opinion. And I think that it needs to be looked at very carefully. Thank you for your time.
Next, we have Tim O'Hare.
Good evening. My name is Tim O'Hare, and my home resides on Delhaven Avenue in the neighborhood adjacent to Whaler's Cove. We are all in agreement that the need for widening Heisey Road was necessary, but in doing so, the widening has created an issue which needs to be addressed. I'm here to discuss the need for a motion-activated traffic signal at the intersection of Whaler's Cove and Heisey Road. As a vehicle approaches Heisey Road while traveling on Whaler's Cove and attempts to turn, there is a section of the northbound lane that bends and falls behind a wall. The driver loses sight of the oncoming vehicle in that lane. The point where the vehicle reappears is extremely sudden and is a safety concern for the vehicle turning. In order to see the oncoming traffic, the driver must extend the front of his vehicle to a point that is blocking the crosswalk. This introduces a second concern for pedestrian safety. Should a person walking or riding a bicycle be traveling on the sidewalk northbound and decide to cross in front of the turning vehicle, there's a strong possibility of the person not to look for oncoming traffic behind them and put themselves in harm's way. This is a hazard whether the vehicle is to turn right or left. I recently attended the work session of City Council and heard the option of making the intersection a right turn only. As I have stated, this is an issue when turning right or left. It has also been stated there is an entrance off Jackson Street through my neighborhood where vehicles can exit. The statement is true, but having lived on Delhaven for 10 years, I can say traffic has increased 2 to 3 times of that prior to construction. The city in the reconstruction obviously has installed sidewalks on either side. Prior to construction, Heisley was not a pedestrian-friendly road. With a park across from two neighborhoods holding 280 homes, the need for pedestrian safety is imperative. The addition of a motion-activated traffic signal has a couple of benefits. The first is allowing the vehicle to remain a safe distance from the intersection with the ability to turn. The second is the benefit of creating a safe passage for the children and adults using the park. Without a light, a person may attempt to run across Heisley Road to the park crossing four lanes of traffic. For these reasons, a motion-activated traffic signal is a necessity. I thank you for your time.
Madam President? Madam President?
Yes, Mr. Blake.
Ken, we had a work session on this 2 weeks ago, and that intersection is in Ward 1, the ward that I represent. And I have to agree with everything that he said. Do we have any update on where we're at with that? Are we moving forward with the possibility of putting an actuated signal there? Because that, my opinion, and I think a great many residents share that opinion, it is a dangerous intersection because of the sight distances when you look to the south. So do we have any update? I know it's only been 2 weeks.
Yes, thank you, Councilman. Well, ultimately, the decision to put a signal there or whatever means necessary to improve the factor of safety there will be council's decision. But we have had some very good communication with ODOT at the district level. They have agreed to send a representative out and to take a look at the situation. Although we're not certain if the resolution would necessarily apply to an actuated signal, they did indicate, and we did some inquiries to determine the other physical improvements that would be related to improving that corridor that resulted from the project, the widening project, could potentially be eligible for a similar funding breakout as was the case with the entirety of their project, which I think was a 50-50 split, right, Dave? Mm. So that's a positive. In fact, Mr. Swigger talked to them today or attempted to talk to them today to find out when we might have a representative out. As the gentleman pointed out, in the interim, I think council as a whole will have to take a close look at this and decide what improvements, if any, need to be made there, because you also have within that, from our point of view, we don't look at just that signal. We're trying to be cognizant and aware of the entire segment of Heisey Road that's really between Jackson Street and that first traffic signal there near the Walmart entrance. Mm-hmm. So we know that there's a park that will be a relatively heavy user, traffic drawer over time. And I think whether there's a signal at Whaler's Cove, whether there's a signal at the park, how we contend with those sight distance issues out of either of those locations has to be looked at in totality together. So we would be asking council to take a look at all the information that we gather, which we're in the process of doing right now, and take a look at that corridor and then help us to make some determinations on what might be the best course of action. At some point, we want to see a safe way to take people from one side of Heisey Road to the other side of Heisey Road. Mm-hmm. We did learn that we could probably go ahead with that traffic signal, nothing more than just our local authority. We feel confident that there are no outside agencies that would interfere with our decision to do that, which is another positive outcome, piece of information to have learned since our last get-together. So ultimately, where we put it and how we resolve the safety factor are things that we're moving closer to a recommendation on.
Good. Thank you, Ken.
Mrs. Dowling. Do you have an approximate time frame what we're looking at? This ballparking? What something like this normally takes?
In terms of
whatever direction recommendation? We're going to go to, yeah, from point A to point B, where's the finish?
Well, one of the things we're doing right now is trying to get some sense of what the traffic draw will be at the park. And engineering has run some traffic generator numbers based on there's no perfect match for that, so we're trying to do a hybrid of based on normal engineering practices dictate in terms of traffic generators for a park facility, and then trying to utilize information that we know exists from some of our facilities and others and in terms of the numbers that we actually see. So obviously if a signal is warranted or a signal is it's determined that a signal be placed in that Heisley Road corridor, you're not going to have two. So you're clearly not going to have one at Whaler's Cove and at the entry to the park, because obviously you would create just a real mess there, and they're in very close proximity now. If we had our druthers, we would align that perfectly and have the entrance across from Whaler's Cove, but if that's to happen, it's going to be long into our future, so we don't control that property. So I think what we're looking at is bringing back some information, and we also have to do a study to determine what the impact if a traffic signal is at either of those locations, what will provide, because again, as we discussed in our first meeting on this and since, you know, anytime you place a traffic signal at any location, you have some unintended consequences going in the opposite direction. So what we know we want to do is help improve the site distance for people who desire to make a left turn out of Whaler's Cove. And we had mentioned at the last meeting, like everything we do, we have different options, we have varying options. One of those is right turn only. Another is to pull back to that retaining wall to increase the site distance. Another option is a traffic signal. But again, you wouldn't make any one of those decisions completely disconnected from decisions that you know are in your not too distant future as it relates to a significant generator of traffic, which will be that public park. So, you know, we certainly encourage anyone who feels uncomfortable making that left turn out of Whaler's Cove now to take the alternate route that I think that gentleman mentioned. There is a relatively safe passageway out onto Jackson Road. Might take a minute or so longer, but it's safer. And until we come up with a longer-term solution, and we're hoping to get some assistance from ODOT on that, and we've had some very encouraging discussions in that regard. And you know, we rely on their professional opinions as well, because they've seen this many times over the years.
Okay, thank you,
Madam President. Just one more comment on that. I think that maybe the next step, and over the next week or two, if I could put together the traffic calming committee to discuss this and bring a recommendation up to council, or we could wait until you have your generation numbers for the park. We could get together, talk about it, and then maybe bring this back up to council for discussion, and then move forward with whatever's going to go in there, because it's not getting safer. And as the snow mounts accumulate whenever we have heavy snow, that just exacerbates the problem and intensifies it. So this is something that I would really like to see us come to a conclusion on in the shortest amount of time, because when summertime comes and everything's wide open there, traffic moving faster will increase the safety. Safety risk of people turning left out of there. So I think that's what I would like to do, is bring this to a traffic calming committee as soon as you're ready with those numbers. Okay, thank you.
I think all of council appreciates the progress that's already been made in a few short weeks, and that we're moving in the right direction, and looking for your lead. And when you're ready to sit down, all of council is more than willing to do so. So I hope that is acceptable with Mr. Blake.
Yes.
Okay. Okay. Is there anything
else,
gentlemen?
Move adjourned.
So moved.
So moved.